Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Isy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua, Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Father in heaven, we thank you for this place. We thank you for each person that's listening. Lord, we just pray that you would open up your word to us. Use Pastor Isy now to speak to each one of us, to encourage us, to show us the way to follow Jesus. We ask this now in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen. Well, guys, if you'd grab your Bibles and turn to Romans 12, verse 9, we're going to pick up on the next paragraph of this chapter. And I have no delusion of thinking I'm going to make it to the end of the chapter. There's just too much juicy stuff, as I said last week, in this portion of Scripture. So we're going to do the next paragraph in this chapter because it's one of the, to me, one of the most power-packed. I mean, you could make every single line of the next paragraph into a sermon by itself, stand alone. That's how good it is. But it's going to go over an idea, so I don't want to take it. I never believe in taking anything out of context in the Scripture. So I use what I call the 20-20 rule. If you want to know what a passage is about, you read a verse or certain idea, and you want to get it in the perspective of what it's being delivered, back up 20 verses, read through the passage you're questioning, and then read ahead 20 more verses. So you get that whole context that's being given in. So this, remember, last week we were seeing Paul was saying in the 2 weeks ago that our spiritual service of worship to God is that we present ourselves to him, living in holy sacrifice. Go, here we are, Lord. Here I am. I present myself to you. Use me how you want to use me. Do whatever you want to do with me. Just use me. Now, how many of you have been doing that over the last couple weeks? Just you wake up, here I am, Lord. Good morning. Whatever you have for me, I'll do it. You know, that's true worship, by the way. That's more spiritual than, you know, some of these folks, they make this big to-do out of, oh, I go to our church and we worship for hours and hours. We have worship-thons, you know. We praise all day long, all night long. And I said, that's great, but did you any time during the singing say, here I am? Here I am, Lord. Yeah, send me. Here I am, Lord, use me. Here I am, do whatever you want. Here I am, do whatever you need to do in me. If there's, like David cried, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit. If there's anything not right in me, if there's anything needs to be fixed, Lord, doctor me up that I could become a reflection of you. And then we saw Paul say that there were a whole bunch of differing gifts that God has given to the body of Christ so that we could be an expression of Christ. You know, and we saw last week, there's all those cool gifts. Everyone likes the gifts. When you talk about the gifts, they're like, their ears perk up. Wait, what gift? What's the gifts? Can I have one? You know, can I have two? You know, how many? What, is there a limit? This is what the kids always ask me. Is there a limit? Like, are we allowed to have the gift of healing and the gift of you know, these different gifts that we were reading, showing mercy? Can we have, can I have 10 gifts? They want to know, what's the limit? Is there really a limit? Do you think with God, how many gifts would he let us to have? Now, the true reality is, I don't think it's a matter of a limit. I think it's a matter of, are we faithful? Remember it says, he who's faithful with a little thing will be put in charge of what? Much. You wanna be given more gifts, be faithful with the gift what he's already given you. The Bible says, let each of us exercise the gifts what we were given. So whatever gift you've been given, just use it. But here today, we're going to come into what I call the attitude that you need to have when it comes to using any gift. Because see, you can have gifts and use them improperly. It's like you could be gifted a knife. Someone gives you a really cool knife. And they say, here. I get this really cool knife. I want to bless you. I only say this because my son-in-law, Robbie, just came back from serving overseas. And thank God he's safe and back home and with my daughter, Joy. And so they're rejoicing. And Robbie has been watching these YouTubes about making knives, where you put the steel in and you fold the steel over and you get different kinds of steel and you sandwich them together and you pound them down. And you keep doing it over and over. They call it Damascus steel. It makes these cool patterns in the steel, like little waves and things. He's like sending me links. You got to check out this guy's thing. And he's asking me, when we come back to Hawaii, which that's a proud papa saying, yeah, they're coming back. So you want to do a forge? And he's already got the anvil, and, you know, and I've got some shop tools. And I'm like, do you want to start making some knives? And he sent me this cool YouTube about this guy who took the steel and folded a gazillion different ways. And when he was done, it looked like the knife, the steel itself, had different kinds of metal making pretty star patterns across the knife blade. Now, I thought, you know, I wonder how much one of those costs. So I Googled it on eBay. They're only like $2,000. I said, we got to make it. You know, this is our budget is we make those kind of things. We don't buy them. But we could, you know, it's a lot of steps, but I'm one of those persistent people. I could do it. You know, just okay. Maybe I'll get some better guns from bang, bang. Because the guy doing it had this big machine, a hydraulic, like, ba-doom, 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 and he's sticking the steel in there and turning it and doing it. I'm thinking, maybe we got to get one. If anyone has one of those you don't need, see me after service. But I don't even know what it's called, but it was like this. Have you seen the hydraulic thing? It just like, yes. Ba-boom, ba-boom, ba-boom. It just keeps hammering the thing. Anyway, I'm daydreaming about it. I'm thinking, okay, so what if someone gave me one of those $2,000 knives? You know, I'd be like, I mean, it's just a knife. But it's a nice knife. I mean, it's a really nice knife. It's a nice gift, right? And you could give me that gift, and I could use that gift. Now, if I do what the Bible says next here in Romans 12:9, and I use this gift with certain attitude, with a certain, how do I say, restraint, that knife could become a real blessing. I mean, I could use that knife to cut someone free. Maybe they get caught in a, you know, in a snare, or something happens, or maybe they get a, you know, one of them wicked splinters, you know, and you got the cool knife. Come here, I got a knife. I can get it out. You know, it's super sharp. Let me just get that little thing. And if you use the knife with precision and properly, can you do good with the knife? Sure. I mean, I was looking at the one that was the one for the kitchen knife because my wife is a really great cook. I was thinking, I mean, she already can do awesome stuff with the knives we got, but they're not with little star patterns, you know, and cool things, you know. I don't know that they cut any better or anything, but they just look cool, okay? So I'm thinking, yeah, if you use the knife to do good, then you've used that gift in the right way. But can you use a knife to hurt someone? In the same manner, sure. It's just like the gifts that God gives to us. They can be used for good, or they can be misused and do harm. I've seen it in the body of Christ. I've seen men misuse the gifts that God has given them, and they do more harm than they do good for the body. And so I want to share with you what Paul shares next in Romans 12 about the attitude and the way, the actions that we use, kind of like a good moral compass. How do I use the knife, or how do I use the gift I was given? Do I use it in the proper way? The very last gift that we saw last week in verse 8, would you look at it with me? And as Paul said, he who leads, let him lead with diligence. He who shows mercy, let him show mercy with what? Cheerfulness. I had to end on that note last week, but this is just to put us back into the context what he was talking about. You know, when someone shows you mercy, mercy is basically not giving you what you deserve. You know, maybe you deserve a punishment, and they go, ah, don't worry. Let's let it. You know, the cop that pulls you over because you were speeding, and you really were speeding, you're not, like, trying to deny, you know, you're busted. And he goes, you know, today I'm going to let you off with a warning. Just next time, pay a little more attention when you come over that hill, not to you know, be going so fast. And if he does that in a merciful way, with cheerfulness, you know, like, you know what, we're just gonna let it go. Have a good day. How do you feel? I mean, any of you ever had that happen? You're probably going, that never happens for me. But if you've had it happen, you're going, oh wow, thank you God, that was cool. But if he sits there and he browbeats you, you know you were going 5 miles an hour over the speed limit, and I could give you a ticket, and I should be, give me your license, you know, and he sits there and drags it out and beats you over the head about it and keeps making you feel terrible. And then he gives you the, you know, I guess I'm going to let you off today. But you best be, never do this again. You know, and he there's no cheerfulness in his mercy. You're just like, give me the ticket. Let me go. You know, I mean, if there's no cheerfulness when the person is showing you mercy, it's not the right use of that gift. Now, did you know that mercy, showing mercy, is a gift? Some people are really full of mercy. They just are. People, they might get, you know, someone backed up and stepped on their toes, and they're just like, don't worry about it. I mean, they're hurting, but they have that cheerfulness. It's okay. Mistakes happen. Don't worry. Those people, by the way, those are the people I like to be around. Because the reality of life is, do we ever step on each other's toes on accident? Even loved ones, you know, moving around the kitchen with my wife, trying to get to the cupboard, you know. It's inevitable that we're going to make a mistake and step on somebody's toes. But to have people around you who are able to show mercy when you make a mistake and do it with cheerfulness, those kind of people, I have to be honest, I think they're very, in my life, I could put them number on one hand. How many people, my Nona, you know, my grandmother, I'd mess up and she'd be like, it's okay, honey. We all make mistakes. Don't worry. And it wasn't like, say, she wasn't saying, go do it again. She was just like, I understand. And we all can move past that. That's part of life. It's part of the growth experience. We all make mistakes. It's part of, you know, and she did it with cheerfulness in a way that, like, man, if I was going to make a mistake, I'd rather make it in front of her than my dad. Because he didn't do mercy with cheerfulness. He did mercy with a stick, and it really was not much mercy. Bend over, grab your ankles. You know, you made a mistake. And I knew that was coming. If I made the mistake and he heard of it, I was in trouble. If I made the mistake and my Nona was there, and she got me first, because sometimes she mellowed my dad out. You know, that's the way, you know, moms can do. But thank you, God. Yeah. It's nice when you do it with cheerfulness. See, that's how mercy has to be used. But see, all of the gifts, starting in verse 9, are going to be couched with a certain quality that if you don't have this quality, I don't care what gifts you have. In fact, Paul, the quality right here, you guys already can look ahead. Verse 9 says, let love be without hypocrisy. Love is the quality that we have to have. In fact, in 1 Corinthians, you remember when Paul said, if I speak with tongues of men or of angels, but I do not have love. This is 1 Corinthians 13:1. Then he says, I'm a noisy gong and I'm a clanging what? Cymbal. I'm a noisemaker, man. If I have all the gifts of the Spirit, but I don't have love, I can prophesy. I can give words of wisdom, words of knowledge. I can discern all mysteries. I can have miracles happen at my fingertips. But I don't have love. So what? It's like having the knife. Without the love, you're just going to misuse it. You're going to hurt people. So he says, here is the quality. Love without hypocrisy. How many of you run into hypocrites in your Christian experience over the years? Anybody? Show of hands. So just raise them up. Let me see. Everybody. Why is that? Why do we run into these hypocrites? You know what a hypocrite is, right? I mean, it's from the Greek hypokritos. It's the word to put on of it's a theatrical word. It's used in theater. It's the putting on of the mask. Back in the Greeks, just think like back to the time when the Greeks did those plays in those amphitheaters, and they're down there on the stage, and they didn't have sound systems like we do today with the, you know, the microphone and amplifier. So what they had was this wooden mask that they would hold up. It had the portrayal, and it was painted with kind of exaggerated features. Like if the guy was portraying the actor being happy at that moment, it had the big exaggerated smile, and the facial expression was bigger than that guy's actual head. You know, it was so that the people way back in the top of the amphitheater could look down and see, here's this, you know, he'd hold up the mask. The actor would hold up the mask in front of him, and it had this big happy face. Or if he's got the sad face, you know, he switched to a different mask. And in each of those masks, there's a little teeny hole for the actor to put his mouth up to and speak, and it's shaped like, from the back to the front, it's a cone. Why did they do that? For the sound, like a megaphone. Right. It amplified their voice. And so they got this thing that they put up in front of their face, and they're talking their lines through the little megaphone, and the people in the back can hear them real good. But could you actually see the facial expression of the actor behind the mask? No. It was hypocritos is literally from the Greek word, the putting on of the mask. Like, you don't know what the real face is behind the mask, because there's a plastic or wooden, in their day, a wooden face in front of the actual person. Now, Christians don't do that, right? We don't put on other faces for people. How you doing today, brother? They're going through like horrible trial. Everything's bad at home, and they go, so how's things going, brother? Fine, thank you for asking. Praise Jesus. And they put on this plasticky, you never run into those people? They put on that fakey, cheesy smile, and you're like, does he think he's fooling somebody? Like, you know. But that's a hypocrite. And see, in our Christianity, do we have to be fake with people? Cover up, like, everything's always perfect. Did Jesus ever say, just act like it's perfect when it ain't perfect? Just put on a fake smile and just smile through it all. Oh, praise Jesus. I don't know about you, but when guys do that to me, I'm like, I just can't. I'm the wrong guy. My wife says I don't have much tact, so I'm improving, she said, though. That's good. But those kind of fellas, I'm like, get out. I don't do well with people that aren't genuine. And see, hypocrisy is those people that are putting on those faces, those fake masks, to they're not really being genuine, the people who they're. It's okay to be who you are in the Lord. I mean, with the Lord, he doesn't, if you're struggling, it's okay to say, Barnabas, I'm struggling today. Could you pray for me? Because if I do that, and he has a gift of praying for people, this guy has a gift, by the way, of interceding. So does that guy over there, Herb, our chaplain. If you're genuine with them and you say, man, I'm really struggling with this, I need prayer. What are they going to do? They're going to kick in on their gifts and start using their gifts in love and start praying for you. And guess what? Well, at the end of this paragraph, one of the conditions for, let me just break this down. Like, this is love without hypocrisy. Okay, I'm going to take, instead of preaching you 9-10 different sermons, each line as its own sermon, I'm going to say these are all subcategories of love without hypocrisy. Okay? This is like real love without hypocrisy broke down in a practical way that, I mean, could be a sermon standalone, each one of them. But let's just put it in our minds. Paul is saying this is love without hypocrisy, step by step by step, how to do love without being a hypocrite. Let's look together at the next part of the verse. It says, let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil. Another translation says, hate what's evil. Cling to what is good. Real, true love. Love that is without being fake, cheesy. Real love hates what is evil. It detests it. Evil is bad. It doesn't say evil, oh, well, some's okay. I just watch a couple horror flicks with the, you know, real satanic stuff. No big deal, Pastor. No, it says to hate what's evil. When it says abhor, it means to turn your eyes away. Abhorring means like so much you hate it so much that if it's in front of you, you turn away from it. You go the other way. That's abhorring. And clinging, see, it's literally the opposite of clinging. It's not clinging, pushing away from. So push away from evil, cling, pull into what is what? Good. When you're really having true love without hypocrisy, you're a person that clings to good. And can people tell when you are a person that pulls good in, that clings, holds on? Can they see that in your life? Sure. I know it's an intangible quality, but people do, they watch us. I mean, if you don't think they do, just ask some non-Christian, hey, do you notice if I'm like going after stuff that's good or am I following, you know, after evil stuff? Because they'll bust you if you are doing wrong. Well, you did have that stuff over in your room. You was, you know, hiding under your bed. I saw it. Isn't it funny how the non-believers know what is evil? Now, they're not abhorring it. They're hanging on to it themselves. But they know you're not supposed to. And when you do it, guess what you're called in their eyes? A hypocrite. First thing we got to do is learn to push away from evil. Hate it. Hate it so bad we turn our eyes off of it. We get it away from us and we go and cling to what is good. When they see us pulling our Bible and putting it on our bed or on our nightstand and it's there, they're like, why has he got a Bible next to his bed? Not a, when I was growing up, it was the smutty magazines, you know, that they put there. I mean, my uncles taught me that stuff. That's clinging to evil. Not good. But see, they watch. And they know whether we're really love without being a hypocrite. What's the next condition, he says? Oh, I love this one. Verse 10. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Devoted. Devotion is something that is, I hate to say it, but it's kind of going away. Like, there's very few people that are really devoted to someone else. And when I say devoted, like, because of my growing up with a military upbringing, you know, my family, all my family members in the military, I have to tell you honestly, the military members, in fact, my son-in-law Robbie said this, that in his Ranger training, he said that in that Rangers group, they teach those guys to, I mean, it's advanced fighting, but he says when you go into a group, you know, into any situation and you're with your other Ranger buddies, he says, you feel like you got each other's back. Like there's this weird feeling of, they're devoted to each other. Like if someone goes down, we're going to get you out. You know, there's no code of, well, you fell, leave you behind, let you bleed out. I mean, there's that no man left behind kind of devotion, like we will get you out. I hate to tell you this, but Christians are terrible at this. Some fellow Christian falls, and what do? Kick him. Hey, you fell. You're down. Step on you. Bad Christian. Shame on you. If the Ranger saw another fellow Ranger fall, he wouldn't kick him. He'd be rushing to his side to get him up. And if he had to put him on his own back and carry him out, he'd carry him out. Because there's a devotion to one another in brotherly. This is brotherly love, okay? Just literally, a brother looking out for a fellow brother. But to that point of covering for each other, if the other one gets hurt, we're there to, we got your back. Do you think that non-Christians watch Christians bite and devour each other? Pick on each other? And then say, I don't want to be in that hypocritical group, man. They're horrible to each other. They kick each other when they're down. In fact, they rejoice. Someone falls and they're like, yay! Did you hear about the minister that fell into sin? Ha, 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 ha. Stupid hypocrites. They pick on them, right? Yeah, they knock them. Because they forgot about being devoted. We should be that if the Rangers are devoted to each other, you know, in the military, in brotherly love, are we not in a spiritual army, so to speak? Remember, Jesus is called we're called Christians. I don't know if you know this. That's a military term. It means Christian is soldier of what? You know this. Soldier of Christ. You're in the Lord's army, whether you didn't know it or not. We're all, you know, some of you are going, but I'm just a cook. Don't worry. They got cooks in the army too. I mean, you got to have all the whole army working together to pull off the battle. And we just saying this morning, who's the battle belong to? To the Lord. But we are in a battle. If you don't realize this, we're in a battle. I mean, just look around. Anyone agree we're in a spiritual battle? I mean, we face it all the time. And we got to quit being hypocrites. We got to, our fellow brother falls in the battle, we got to rush to their side and help them. Help them up, get them off the battlefield, get them back to the hospital, and get them doctored up. Well, he says the next part of our instruction for love without hypocrisy, after being a people that is devoted to one another in brotherly love, is that we give preference to one another, and we give to one another honor. Give preference to one another. I'm sorry, in honor. In honor. You know, honoring someone, it was modeled for me because my father always showed great respect to his parents' generation. I didn't have to have anyone, like, give me really what I call verbal instructions that you are to give preference to your elders. You come to a door when you're a young man with my dad, and what's my, if my dad is with my grandparents, what's my dad do when we get to the door? Reaches over, opens the door, and who's he let go through the door first? Him, does he rush through? No. He holds the door for my grandmother, my nono, go. He lets them go first. And then he's the one that is, you know, and I was taught respect for my elders. It was just, but it was modeled. You're at the buffet line, and it's time to go up and get the, and you know, the man standing there carving the nice prime rib or whatever. And you're looking at it, ooh, a little kid. And, you know, if I was with my grandparents and my parents, I wasn't allowed to go to the front of the line unless they said, come up here. Because I was taught that my grandfather gets to go first. He did the most work, the most years, and in honor of that, I have to give him preference. You know, he goes first. Now, this is something that I almost hate to say this, but I feel like it's a lost concept for the generation coming up under me. Like, they don't really, they go, what? You want me to let someone else in line in front of me? The buffet? Hey, but there's only one chocolate cupcake at the end. What if they get it? You know what? What if they get it? If you're giving preference to them in honor, if it's my grandfather and he was in line in front of me and he took it and that's the last one, you know what I was taught? He deserves it. That's honoring him. As a Christian, do we practice this where we say to our other fellow believers, here, I give preference to you. You go first. You have the opportunity to get the nice thing first. That's really, and by the way, the world is watching us. Men, the Bible tells us we have to love our wives the way Christ loved the church. If we do this for our wives, do other people see us? Because, you know, we're just modeling how much Christ loves the church in our lives by how we love our wives. And if we open the door for our wives, we let them go through the buffet first, we give preference to them in honor, the world's watching, they go, that guy really loves his wife. Look how he is with her. That's a living example of Christ. And they'll say, that guy's not a hypocrite. But the guy's a jerk. He goes, yeah. You know, everyone out of my way, I'm getting my food. You know, sometimes my boys, they say they get hungry plus angry. That's hangry. They get hangry, and they're like, everyone out of the way! You know, and they just push and shove and get to the food first. And that's not giving preference and honor. And whether you realize it or not, people watch us even when we're hangry. I hate to tell you this. Like, I have to, like, kind of rein it in myself because I kind of get there real quick. I try to eat small meals through the day. I miss one meal. You don't want to meet me in a couple hours. You want to make sure you call up and say, Pastor, would you like to go have a bite to eat and talk about something? That's the best thing because, you know, when you eat six times a day, you've improved your odds of meeting with me. You have first breakfast or second breakfast, first lunch, second lunch, first dinner. I mean, I'm more available for a fellowship. That's all. But if I miss a meal, you don't want to have a counseling time with me. Because that same thing, what I see, what comes out of my boys, comes out of me. The blood sugar dips, and the brain just goes foggy, and the world's probably going, what a cranky pastor. Somebody feed him. You know? It's just one of those things that we got to, this is all to protect us from becoming hypocrites. If we live these instructions right here, we can guard ourselves from this hypocrisy. Now, there's a few more. I don't even know what time. Have I gone too long? 30 minutes already? Oh, jeepers. Wait. The paragraph goes all the way to verse 13. There's like 10 more sermons here, but okay. Wait, I'll just read them to you, okay? In context, why don't you get the context about not being a hypocrite, okay? Maybe next week I break down a few more of them, because these are like, they really are standalone sermons. The next part of not being a hypocrite is found in verse 11. It says that we not lag behind in diligence. You ever met someone that's diligent? What does it mean, by the way? Just like help me put it into today's vernacular for the... We have a lot of new believers listen to this thing later. They don't know these words, diligence. That's like, what is it? Persistence. Faithful to keep going. You're that person that just hangs in there. I mean, you don't get shaken by some, oh no, something bad happened, I'm going to quit. You don't quit. Someone that is got diligence, they don't lag in it. They're those kind of people that, I mean, stuff goes wrong and they're just like, it's okay, we're going to work through it. That's a person who isn't lagging in diligence. The people that can press on, persist, and make it. Now, does the world watch us to see if we're like that? What if we say, yeah, I'm a Christian, but as soon as it gets hard or something bad happens, I'm out of this club, man. I just don't feel like doing Jesus today. If you listen to some Christians, I hate to tell you this, but some Christians, they really live this kind of yo-yo Christian experience. Like one day at church, they're all holy and spiritual and, oh, Jesus, praise the Lord. And then the next day they're in traffic swearing at people and, you know, and you're like, what happened to your Christianity? It's like it left. I left it at the beach, the church. That's not what we call, well, that's not staying diligent. That's not continuing in the faith. That's not pressing on. The next part says, and the next line is being fervent in the spirit. Fervent means fiver. Fervor is the word we get for fire. You got to have that. Can people see if we have fire for the Lord? I mean, that's one of the things people come up to me sometimes. They don't even know me, and they're like, you have like a bright glow about you, a light. There's like a fire. I had people come up and tell me, you have a golden aura around you. You have like a bright flame over your head. And I'm like, it's the Lord. I quit. Like, don't even waste time. Just like tell them what it is. It ain't me. If they see something like, and by the way, can people who maybe don't even know Christ perceive, have perceptions about spiritual things? Can they even feel darkness? You know, some of them are very sensitive. Man, it feels like there's demons or something around. And you say, do you believe in God? I don't know, but I'm pretty sure there's demons. Isn't that strange how some people are very familiar with the dark side, but they're very unlearned when it comes to things of the light? Why do you think God put us here? Jesus said, let your light so shine before men that they see your good works and they glorify God in heaven. When they look at you, they should be going, man, that light really helped me. That they had the light of the Lord shining through them. I'm just drawn to the light. Well, we need to be fervent, on fire in spirit, and serving. Now, this is so important to guard us from hypocrisy. Who do you serve? It says right here who you're supposed to serve. You want to see it? See it there at the end of verse 11? Serving who? Yourself, right? Serving others? No. Who does it say we have to be busy serving to not be a hypocrite? The Lord. Serve the Lord.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo and God bless.